Modern science will tell you that it is impossible for the earth to be hollow. This same modern science will tell you that man came from a monkey and there are no such things as UFOs. The official position of the Church, the Holy Roman Inquisition, was that the earth was flat. The emerging scientists began to realize that this was wrong and eventually proved it to the world. The Church was wrong, and therefore the Bible must have been wrong. Today, in the minds of too many people, the Bible has lost its validity because men were wrong. It is interesting to note that the Bible declared the earth was round long before there was a modern science or the Church. In the Old Testament, we find this passage. It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them out like a tent to dwell in. The Bible has always remained true. It is man's own interpretation, or rather the lack of proper interpretive procedures, that are flawed. We may also have the similar problem with the idea of a hollow earth. Most evangelical Christians profess belief in a literal hell. When pressed to define where it is, most will point to the ground or define this never-never land in another dimension on some spiritual plane idea. This uncertainty may come from the conflict or apparent conflict of a biblical description compared to the modern so-called scientific position. Sir Edmund Halley, astronomer, mathematician, and yes, the comet guy, in 1692 published his theory about a hollow earth. His theory was developed from working with Sir Isaac Newton on earth magnetism fluctuations and the possible causes. His solution, the earth was hollow. He believed that there were three concentric cones with a molten lava core which served as an inner sun. Originally, the early American government took the idea of a hollow earth seriously. The Smithsonian Institute was built expressly for the purpose of containing the findings from a hollow earth from the failed expedition of 1838 and 1840 led by Charles Wilkes to the Antarctic. The expedition was based on the work of a retired American military officer turned hollow earth researcher John Sims and had the approval of the President John Quincy Adams and the United States Congress. Many other attempts followed by other countries and other U.S. explorations produced the same failed results leading right up into modern times today. The 1938 Nazi expedition will prove to be the most important to the conclusion of our story and will be discussed further in the last part of this series. Beginning in the early 20th century, after many failed attempts to discover an opening to a hollow earth by U.S. and many other countries, modern science began to conclude that the whole idea was impossible, and the social attitude changed from one of acceptance to laughable foolishness. Because of this, the Church has taught a vague, unclear concept of hell, trying to bridge this gap of assumed science and the biblical descriptions by separating spirit and flesh and the physical from the ethereal. It also has blinded us to an important element to the story of end-time events, as we shall see later. The actual evidence, scientifically, is no more conclusive about a hollow earth than it is about evolution or UFOs. They all include an element of faith, not conclusive scientific facts to believe in. The actual fact is that we, at least the public, know very little about inner earth conditions. In spite of the demands made by modern science, we have never probed beyond the crust, and any ideas spoken from anyone are only unproven theories and hypotheses. Science, by its own standards, has failed to prove the earth is solid or hollow. One modern-day geophysicist claims that there is valid scientific proof that hollow planets and moons may be the norm and not even the exception. It is interesting to note in America that there are two laws about the underground that seem suspicious. Did you know that you have to have a special permit to explore caves even on private property anywhere in the United States? Cave locations are exempt from the Freedom of Information Act, and you cannot get access to this information from our government. There are many different ideas of what a hollow earth could be like. We will look at some of the most popular theories. One is Halley's, which describes a series of concentric cones layered within themselves, as I have already stated, and the other states that there is a series of long tubular caves and caverns as large inner voids that give the appearance of a hollow earth. The last one claims that an inner outer landmass with a huge hollow void and a central core serving as an inner sun with holes at the poles are the reality. The bottom line is that we do not know for sure what just lies beneath the outer crust of the earth. Legends and myths are universal about a hollow earth as the creation and the flood stories of the Bible, as mentioned in part one. that may be where we have to go to get a description of what lies below the surface of the earth with any kind of assured accuracy. This would only be relative to if you believe the Bible is the Word of God and that many things can be taken in a literal sense. The first place we will look at in the Bible is Luke 16:19 through 26. While speaking to his disciples about stewardship, faith, and forgiveness, Jesus told an actual literal story of Lazarus and the rich man. He does not name the rich man, but he names the beggar Lazarus. Whenever Jesus spoke a parable, he never used personal names or specific geographical locations. The proper rule of interpretation is whenever names are used for persons or geographical locations, this text is to be taken as a narrative of an actual historical and literal event. Among evangelists, this text and quote by Jesus is taken as a literal historical narration of a real event. Understanding this, the descriptions of the geography must also be literal and true. Luke 16:19-26. There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at the gate, full of sores, and desiring to be fed with crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that he died, and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died, and was buried. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and said, saw Abraham far off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted and you are tormented. And besides all this, between you, us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from here to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from here. Now let's look at the geographical details described in this text and disregard the spiritual implications for now. We have two areas or chambers separated by a gulf or a chasm, which is fixed. When we hear of Abraham's bosom, we usually think of the upper front body part area between the arms. Some say this is an allegorical reference for a fondness. The proper meaning here has been lost by a cultural expression common 2,000 years ago but foreign in today's world. Any Bible dictionary will reveal to you that bosom refers to the bosom of a garment. That is the hollow formed by the upper forepart of a tunic. This is a rather loose garment bound by a girdle or sash around the waist used for keeping and carrying things, the upper fold or the pocket. This literal event told by Jesus describes a two-part pocket that is eternal or subterranean. One area is negative and one positive, but separated between each other by a gulf. This was the Old Testament concept of hell or Sheol as being a place where all departed souls went into one or the other place. But notice from the text, even though departed spirits lived there, it was also a very physical place inside the earth. The Bible contains additional scripture to support this idea of a two-chambered hollow earth. Psalms 116:3 states, "The sorrows of death compass me, and the pains of hell got a hold upon me. I found trouble and sorrow." The word pains in Hebrew is metzar, meaning something tight. It comes from the Hebrew word kabah, meaning a paunch, as in the cavity, or the first stomach of a cud-chewing animal. They have more than one stomach. So you can see that in the etymology of the word for pain, we get an understanding of a two-chambered hollow earth. In addition, words such as sea, abyss, pit, and the deep interchangeably mean the same place within the earth. When the flood waters came, the fountains of the deep burst forth to the surface, as described in Genesis 6. Where did they burst? Subterranean. H.M. Howell, a Christian educator, wrote in his book, Cosmic Problems Solved, in 1895, he believed that a parallel existed between the ocean currents and the four rivers mentioned in Genesis 2:10-14, as flowing out of Eden. Edenden would be on the concave side of the globe, with the waters welling out through the hole at the South Pole, completing its course back into the Earth at the opening in the North Pole. Current theories of the location of Eden do not match up with the modern geography, and even known changes from the ancient conditions give no conclusive results. Some have even tried to say Eden is in another dimensional plane on the same Earth, and that is why we cannot find it. But a further search in the scriptures can provide a better logical answer. The death and resurrection of Jesus created the bridge back and the way for all who believe in him. Ephesians 4:9 says, "Now this he ascended, what does it mean but that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth?" Two different results from two different areas were accomplished by Jesus in this inner realm. Matthew 27:52 and 53 said, "And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose, and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many." After this resurrection, the upper half of Sheol was left empty. Now upon death of those born by the Spirit, they go directly to be with the Lord in the heavenly dimension, as mentioned in 2 Corinthians 5:18, or 5:8. In the lower chamber, Jesus declared something to the fallen angels and their offspring from the Genesis 6 event. 1 Peter 3:18-20 states, "And being put to death in the flesh," meaning Jesus, "but made alive by the Spirit, by whom he also went and preached to the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient, when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared." Preached, in contextual use, does not mean that Jesus preached the gospel. The word, without a modifier, simply means to declare something. The contextual use of the spirits refers to disembodied angelic spirits, not human ones. A further description of this visitation by Jesus is mentioned by the prophet Isaiah as declaring a further judgment on the angels of sin mentioned in Genesis 6 and Isaiah 26. In the next part of the series, we will discuss this in more detail. For our sake here, it is important to see that Jesus went to both chambers right after his death and before his ascension into heaven. Understanding this by the Bible's own statements draws some rather interesting conclusions to the two chambers that are mentioned. The lower chamber is the realm called hell, and commonly understood as a place for all things damned, angelic or human. What is not understood is the full understanding of just what this empty upper realm is. If Abraham's bosom, as defined by Jesus' own word, is the inner realm that he went to upon his death on the cross, as the Bible clearly indicates, we need to take notice of what else Jesus called this realm. Jesus told the thief next to him on the cross that, "Today you shall be with me in paradise." Now keep in mind, after the cross, Jesus did not ascend into heaven first. He went down, then up. Jesus went into the bowels of the earth, to Abraham's bosom, where Lazarus went, which was paradise, along with the thief, as promised. At this time, all were released and ascended into the very presence of the Lord. The upper chamber is now empty of the faithful and sealed somehow from entrance. It is very important to understand this connection, because many further implications are made by this. The Bible will always define itself by itself. It is amazing, after these clear connections, that we have another verse that defines for us something more about paradise. Revelation 2:7 states, "To him that overcomes will I grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God." We know that the tree of life is in the Garden of Eden. There is only one tree of life. That would mean that Eden and paradise are one and the same, and so is Abraham's bosom. Where are they? Inside a hollow earth. It would also mean that H.M. Howell, over 100 years ago, had it biblically correct. The Garden of Eden, then, is not on the surface in some invisible never-neverland or forgotten ethereal place, but subterranean. Many cultural myths of man ascending from an inner earth are but a trace memory of what the Bible concurs, and it gets even stranger. What about openings to a hollow earth? Could some of the ideas of holes at the poles have any merit? Most all of the explorations by all nations searching for a hollow Earth in the 19th and late 20th centuries were directed to the Arctic and Antarctic poles by their knowledge about ancient myths, legends, possible history, and some even by the scriptures in the Bible. Recent satellite pictures over the North Pole have been revealing, to say the least. Why have we not heard of this controversy in the news? Almost all nations who can afford to have an outpost around the Arctic and Antarctic areas for scientific studies and research are present in both locations. Our own Air Force has Project HARP, High Frequency Active Auroral Research Program, is a huge antenna array directed toward the North Pole. HARP carries its own legendary mysteries like Area 51 in Roswell. Does the Bible shed any light on any of this? I think it does. Job 38:30. The waters are hid as with a stone, and the face of the deep is frozen. This is very interesting indeed. The waters hid are the internal waters of the deep or abyss, the subterranean waters. The excess flood waters, now frozen, covers the face or opening of the abyss like a stone on top of it. This covering of ice over the openings are what we call the Arctic and Antarctic circles. The actual process is described in the scriptures also. Psalms 33:7 says, He gathered the waters of the great sea together, and as a heap he layeth up the depth in storehouses. Also, Job 26:10, He hath compassed about the waters with bounds until the day and night come to an end. He hath compassed literally means he inscribed a circle to cover over the face of the subterranean waters. The words have an emphasis that this is a transfer resulting in hiding the subterranean storehouse like a treasure. The idea of a transfer suggests a change from a prior condition. This is described in 2 Peter 3, 5-7. Before there was a flood, there was a complete easy access in and out of both realms. 2 Peter 3, 5 and 7 says, For this is they are willingly ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and of the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that was then, being overflowed with water, perished. But the heavens and the earth, which are now, by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of godly and ungodly men. The Greek word for earth means, in its general term, arable land. The Greek word synesteo, for standing, is better rendered as united together. In this sense, submerged land or flooded land is not what is mentioned here, but rather surface land out of the waters and surface land in the waters as subterranean. With this understanding, we can see that the arable land was united together out of the water and in the water, but the flood changed this. Verse 6 states that the world, as an ordered arrangement that existed before this, was destroyed or changed by Noah's flood. Now the face or openings at the poles are covered over by the frozen waters and the inner and outer realms separated from each other. The upper chamber, the Arctic North Pole, according to Job 26:10, will be part frozen, exposed, and yet had some kind of boundary set before it, making it unapproachable until the end of time. The lower chamber, the Antarctic South Pole, is frozen over and sealed off, but it will be breached at some time in our history. The prophet Amos describes this in his book, which will be discussed in the next part. A possible rendering of Job 26:8 states this breaking in or breaching. He binds up the waters as a thicket or like as a fortress before broken into a hidden opening underneath. One chamber is empty of population and its opening is sealed off by some kind of border until the end of time. The other chamber thrives with a rebel alliance population destined to make an alliance with surface dwellers and will invade it from below. Nothing down there is any good or has any redemptive value. The only inhabitants there are rebels, be they fallen angels in Tartarus, the lower level of Hades, or departed souls of Adam, an upper level of Hades, or east of Eden in the land of Nod, tall, blonde-haired, blue-eyed, human descendants of Cain. Yes, in the next section we will describe by scripture the residents and their prophetic role in the future. We will also describe the breach in the South Pole and the encounter of the surface rebels of God and the subterranean rebels that form the final end-time army of darkness. The real kings of the east and the inner earth invasion from a hollow earth upon the surface in the last days. They will appear to come from the heavens or outer space, but will actually come from below, coming soon to your planet and your hometown.